Dear colleagues, it's a great pleasure to discuss with you what are, from my perspective, the most important breast cancer abstracts presented at ASCO 2020. It has been a special conference considering that due to all the COVID-19 related issues that we know unfortunately very well, this conference has moved to an online only event, a virtual conference only. But despite that, I think that in the breast cancer track it has been a great event with many important data presented in both the advanced as well as early setting. I will start reviewing the most important abstract in the advanced setting, and before going to the different breast cancer subtypes, I will start with the ECOG-2108 trial, which is a study that assessed the role of local treatment in patients with de novo stage 4 breast cancer, and this was presented in the plenary session of ASCO 2020. In this trial, asking a very highly relevant clinical question, 390 patients with de novo stage 4 breast cancer were registered before starting first-line treatment. And those patients without disease progression between 4 to 8 months following the start of first-line treatment were randomized to receive or not local therapy. Around 250 patients were randomized, the majority, more than 60%, having hormone receptor-positive disease, a third of them HER2-positive disease, and less than 10% triple-negative breast cancer. And the study did not show any difference in survival outcomes between patients who received or did not receive local treatment. No difference in progression-free survival, no difference in overall survival. And interestingly, at the subgroup analysis of progression-free survival according to tumor subtype, there was no difference in the HER2-positive and hormone receptor-positive cohort, while in the triple-negative subset, even though this was a small cohort, there was a trend towards worse outcome for patients who received local therapy as compared to those who did not receive any local treatment. The use of local therapy reduced the risk of local progression, but with no difference in quality of life between the two treatment arms. So this trial is telling us that local therapy in patients with de novo stage 4 breast cancer should not always be proposed to patients. However, as also discussed by the discussant, there is still a role for this option, for sure for patients with local symptoms or local progression, but it probably has a role also for patients with de novo oligometastatic disease. However, in this specific setting, probably more data, more evidence from trials is needed before considering the standard option also in this specific subgroup of patients. Moving to the HER2-positive data, I think two important trials have been presented. HER2-CLIMB reporting more data in the specific cohort of patients with CNS disease, and FOEBE trial presenting data on the role of pirotinib. So both trials presenting data on the two tyrosine kinase inhibitor in the HER2-CLIMB tucatinib. This was a phase 3 randomized trial in patients that progressed after receiving pertuzumab, trastuzumab, and T-DM1, so a kind of third-line treatment according to our current standard. Patients were randomized to receive trastuzumab plus capecitabine with or without tucatinib. The primary endpoint of the trial was presented at San Antonio last year and published in the New England Journal of Medicine. This led to the FDA approval of tucatinib in this setting. At ASCO 2020, we had the presentation and the simultaneous publication in the Journal of Clinical Oncology of the data for the specific cohort of patients with CNS disease, so with brain metastasis, and I remind that in this trial, almost half of the population included had CNS at the time of randomization, CNS disease at the time of randomization, so around 300 patients. The tucatinib shows a high activity also in patients with brain metastasis, significantly improving progression-free survival, overall survival, response rate, also in the CNS, almost doubling the number of responses in the CNS from 20% to more than 40%, And importantly, it also delay and reduce the risk of progression in the brain, so the so-called CNS PFS, more than 60% reduced risk of progressing in the brain, with 40% of patients still free from progression in the brain at 12 months after randomization in the tucatinib arm, as compared to 0% in the placebo arm, showing high activity of this agent, especially for the above all for patients with CNS disease. In the other trial, the FOEBE trial, another TKI has been assessed in this the pirtobrutinib, differently from tucatinib, which is a highly selected anti-HER2 TKI. Pirtobrutinib is a pan HER TKI targeting HER1, HER2, and HER4. Last year at ASCO, we had a presentation of the phase 3 randomized trial of capecitabine plus pirtobrutinib versus capecitabine. This year, we had a presentation of the FOEBE trial, so similar design, but the capecitabine plus pirtobrutinib arm was compared to the kind of standard of care capecitabine plus lapatinib. The trial was conducted in China in patients that did not receive prior pertuzumab nor prior T-DM1, so it's not really the patient population that we would treat with capecitabine plus lapatinib in my country, for example. However, the trial showed very important data for the favoring the use of pirtobrutinib over lapatinib, with almost a doubling in the median progression-free survival from around 7 months with lapatinib to more than 12 months with pirtobrutinib. And an important trend favoring pirtobrutinib also in terms of overall survival, so that based on this data, this drug has been approved in China. Moving to the hormone receptor positive population, again in the advanced setting, I would like to mention two trials that I think have really clarified what is our sequencing of treatment in the advanced setting. The first trial, the Parsifal study from the Spanish group, first-line trial in the endocrine-sensitive population, randomizing patient pre- and postmenopausal women with endocrine-sensitive disease to first-line palbociclib plus AI letrozole, and in the other arm, palbociclib plus fulvestrant. So it was a head-to-head comparison between fulvestrant and an AI together with a CDK4/6 inhibitor in the endocrine-sensitive population. The trial has a strong rationale because we have data suggesting that fulvestrant is superior to an AI as single agent in the endocrine-sensitive population, and also we have very interesting results from the MONALEESA-3 trial in the endocrine-sensitive cohort with the use of fulvestrant plus ribociclib, suggesting very long progression-free survival with this combination. However, this trial did not show any difference between the two treatment arms in terms of progression-free survival nor in overall survival. And importantly, there was a very promising progression-free survival data also with the combination of AI plus palbociclib with a 33-month median progression-free survival, so more than 2.5 years of median progression-free survival with CDK4/6 inhibitor plus an AI in the endocrine-sensitive population, so confirming once again the clear effect of this combination in the advanced setting. And in the second trial, the BYLieve study that was a three-arm phase 2 trial, open label, three cohort, non-randomized trial. In this study, the author tested the role of alpelisib in different specific patient population, and we had a presentation of the first cohort of patients. So those patients progressing after CDK4/6 inhibitor and an aromatase inhibitor, testing the role of fulvestrant plus alpelisib if PI3K mutated. So this is actually what we could consider nowadays the most proper sequencing of treatment for patients progressing after AI plus CDK4/6 inhibitor. What is the activity of alpelisib plus fulvestrant? We had data also from the SOLAR-1 trial in this specific subgroup of patients. However, it was only a small subgroup of patients in the trial. In this study, more than 100 patients progressing on CDK4/6 inhibitor and an AI receive fulvestrant and alpelisib in this cohort, and the study show important activity of this drug in this specific setting, with more than 50% of patients still free from disease progression at 6 months, and an important median progression-free survival of around 7 months in this specific cohort, suggesting the clinical activity of this drug also in patients progressing after AI plus CDK4/6 inhibitor. In the triple-negative cohort, the most important data derived from the KEYNOTE-355 trial, a much-awaited phase 3 trial, first-line treatment, triple-negative disease, randomized to receive chemotherapy or chemotherapy plus immune therapy, pembrolizumab in this study, and the chemotherapy backbone in the two trials could be Abraxane, single agent, paclitaxel single agent, or the combination of carboplatin plus gemcitabine. And the trial show important efficacy of the combination of the addition of immune therapy to chemotherapy only in the PD-L1 positive cohort, and specifically in the so-called CPS more equal or more than 10 cohort, with a trend favoring the use of immunotherapy also in the cohort of patients with CPS more than 1, so with any type of PD-L1 positivity. However, as mentioned, the trial met its primary endpoint and statistical significance only in the CPS 10, more than 10 cohort. In this specific cohort, very similar data as those shown with atezolizumab plus Abraxane in the PD-L1 positive population in patient 130. In this specific regard, the progression-free survival improved by around 4 months with a hazard ratio of 0.65. So I think that as soon as pembrolizumab will be approved for this specific cohort of patients, we will have now two different immunotherapy options to be considered and to decide in the first-line treatment for patients with triple-negative breast cancer and PD-L1 positivity. In the triple-negative cohort, there are two other phase 2 single-arm trials that I would like to mention. The first presented as poster discussion with a combination of bicalutamide and palbociclib in patients with hormone receptor ne ER-negative, HER2-negative, and androgen receptor-positive disease, with very nice and interesting clinical benefit rate with this combination, more than 36% at 6 months clinical benefit rate, opening the door for a potential phase 3 trial in this setting. And then the second important single-arm phase 2 study that actually does not apply only to triple-negative patients, but it's of particular importance for the triple-negative population, is the TBCRC048 trial, in which around 50 patients received olaparib single agent. Patient with germline mutation other than BRCA or somatic mutation, including potentially BRCA somatic mutation in the absence of germline BRCA mutation. And among all the patients included, those that derived the highest benefit from the use of olaparib single agent were two groups of patients: those with germline PALB2 mutation, more than 80% objective response rate in this specific cohort of patients, and the second group of patients, those with somatic BRCA mutation without germline BRCA mutation, with around 50% clinical benefit rate, objective response rate. So I think that this trial is actually opening the door to the potential use of PARP inhibitor also beyond germline BRCA mutated patient. Moving now to the early setting, again going into the main three different tumor subtypes. I will start with the HER2-positive subtype, and here we had a presentation of three main studies, all of them testing a kind of de-escalated approach. I will start with the CATHERINE trial, which is the largest in terms of number of patients included. This was a phase 3 trial including more than 1,800 patients with HER2-positive disease, node positive or node negative, but tumor larger than 2 cm or hormone receptor and hormone receptor negative. So a kind of population that received first surgery. So this is a type of population that we currently treat mostly with neoadjuvant treatment. However, in this study, patients were randomized after receiving surgery to receive anthracycline-based chemotherapy, 3-4 cycles of anthracycline-based chemotherapy, and then in one treatment arm, patient receive standard taxane plus pertuzumab plus trastuzumab, and in the other arm, the taxane was not given, and instead of giving taxane, the combination of T-DM1 plus pertuzumab was given. The trial, however, was negative, did not show any difference in invasive disease-free survival between the two treatment arms. And the most important findings is the very good outcomes observed in both arms with an invasive disease-free survival despite being a kind of a high-risk patient population of more than 93% in both treatment arms. The other two trials, the TRAIN-2 study and the FairGAIN, again studied two different kind of potential de-escalated approaches. The first trial, the TRAIN-2, is a Dutch study that already reported the primary result, the pathologic complete response in The Lancet Oncology a couple of years ago. This was a study in which the authors treated patients with HER2-positive disease in the neoadjuvant setting, randomizing them to receive or not anthracycline together with dual anti-HER2 blockade, trastuzumab and pertuzumab. So in one arm, patient receive FAK chemotherapy followed by taxane, carboplatin, all the treatment given with dual anti-HER2 blockade. In the other arm, patient did not receive the anthracycline portion of the chemotherapy, but received more cycle, and actually a total of 9 cycle of the combination of taxane, carboplatin, again with dual anti-HER2 blockade. In The Lancet Oncology a couple of years ago, the author presented the lack of difference in pathologic complete response between the two treatment arms. At ASCO this year, the author reported survival outcome at 3 years, showing again no difference between the two treatment arms, suggesting that in some patients we may potentially de-escalate chemotherapy and spare the use of anthracycline, with still very good survival data at 3 years with an event-free survival again exceeding 93% in both treatment arms. And very good overall survival data with more than 98% overall survival in both treatment arms at 3 years. The third study, the FairGAIN, I think this is a very, very interesting study, very complex design. I will try to briefly mention what is the portion of the trial that has been presented at ASCO. In this study, patient with HER2-positive disease were randomized to receive taxane-based chemotherapy with TCHP, so docetaxel, carboplatin, and dual anti-HER2 blockade, the trastuzumab plus pertuzumab for 6 cycles, and the PET scan at baseline and after 2 cycles. In the other arm, patient received only dual anti-HER2 blockade for the first 2 cycles, so before receiving the second PET scan. So pertuzumab plus trastuzumab, and then after the first 2 cycles, patient not responding to the first 2 cycles received TCHP chemotherapy for 6 cycles, and those patients who responded continue to receive dual anti-HER2 blockade without chemotherapy until surgery. And those patients at surgery that achieved PCR despite not receiving chemo were spared chemotherapy also in this post-surgical part. At this ASCO, the author presented the first part of the results of the first part of the trial, showing that around 80% of patients receiving pertuzumab plus trastuzumab for the first two cycles actually responded according to PET scan after two cycles, and among these patients, up to 40% achieve a pathologic complete response without receiving any type of chemo. So I think that this is a very important study. Of course, we need to wait the survival data to better assess the possibility to de-escalate chemotherapy in this patient, but this study provides very important and promising data to potentially find a niche and a specific patient population for whom we can spare chemotherapy in the HER2-positive setting. Moving to the hormone receptor-positive subtype, the luminal subtype, the most important data, I think, is the updated analysis from the MINDAC trial, the study in assessing the role of genomic, of mamma print, of genomic tests to potentially de-escalate chemotherapy use in this specific, in the specific cohort of patients with hormone receptor-positive disease. The trial already reported results at 5 years, which was the primary endpoint of the study. For patients with clinically high risk but genomic low risk, the primary endpoint of the study was to find a distant disease-free survival, distant metastasis-free survival more than 92% in this cohort of patients that did not receive chemotherapy. With more mature data at almost 9 years of median follow-up, the trial still confirmed to be positive in the sense that the 5-year distant metastasis-free survival was more than 92%. So the lower boundary of the confidence interval was more than 92%. And mamma print confirmed to have an important prognostic role in this specific patient population. However, at the longer follow-up, there are some interesting data in terms of potential chemotherapy benefit in the discordant group. So patients that receive or not chemotherapy with discordant clinical or genomic risk. So with longer follow-up, the difference and the potential benefit of chemotherapy appear to be larger, with around 2.5% absolute benefit of chemotherapy in the overall patient population. But interestingly, the results appear to be mostly present in the premenopausal patient population, with almost 5% absolute difference in outcomes at 8 years in this specific setting. Suggesting that considering that most of these patients receive tamoxifen alone as adjuvant endocrine therapy, the author suggested that the potential benefit of chemotherapy, they could not exclude that this could be somehow also related to the benefit of ovarian function suppression obtained with the use of chemotherapy instead of the real benefit of chemotherapy. However, I think that this data should be discussed with caution with our patient, and the potential benefit of chemotherapy in this setting should not be should be disclosed specifically in patients younger than 50 years. In patients older than 50 years, apparently there was no major difference between with or without the use of chemotherapy. In the hormone receptor-positive population, there were other two neoadjuvant trials to be presented, two neoadjuvant studies, both of them unfortunately negative studies. In one study alternate study, the author tested AI, anastrozole versus fulvestrant versus a combination of the two. In the other trial, letrozole with or without two different schedules of ribociclib, but in all these studies, there was no difference as compared to AI alone treatment in terms of response to to this treatment assessed with the PEPI score, so with the PEPI 0 score at the time of surgery. Finally, moving to the triple negative subtype, only one trial that I wanted to mention is the Chinese study assessing the role of metronomic capecitabine as adjuvant treatment in triple negative breast cancer patients receiving standard adjuvant or neoadjuvant chemotherapy. In the trial, more than 400 patients were randomized to receive a year of capecitabine metronomic with a metronomic schedule as compared to observation. And the study was significantly in favor of the use of capecitabine with a significant improvement in disease-free survival at 5 years, almost 10% absolute improvement, and a non-significant but interesting trend favoring the use of capecitabine also in terms of overall survival. So I think this trial further supports the use of capecitabine in high-risk patients with triple-negative disease after receiving standard neoadjuvant and neoadjuvant chemotherapy.